to Connie Martinson Talks Books. He was a man who, like Columbus discovered America, Sigmund Freud changed the world. But what was he like as a man? Well, my two guests today, Karen Mack and Jennifer Kaufman, have co-authored Freud's Mistress. It's a novel. It's published by Putnam Books. It's an Amy Einhorn book. Welcome, Karen. Welcome, Jennifer.
Thank you.
And how awful to be Freud's wife. Better to be his mistress. And that is a story of Minna, who was his wife's sister.
His wife's younger, attractive, intelligent sister.
Yeah. Wife is Martha. Her parents evidently liked the initial M, and they were there. But I'd love to have you read the first page that talks sort of how Minna felt about the world.
I'd love to. Thanks. Vienna, 1895. The season for suicides had begun. The young woman sat at the writing desk by the window and dipped her pen into black ink. It scratched across the paper like a raven's claw. Outside, the sky was ashen gray. Since early November, the air had been bitter cold and patches of ice had spread over the breadth of the Danube. Soon, the river would be frozen solid until spring. Just the other week, she had read in the Sahlenblatt about a wealthy young aristocrat dressed in bridal gown and veil who jumped her steed off Kronprinz Rudolf Bridge. The beautiful filly sank like a stone, and the woman's body washed up on the shore, shrouded in white satin. She never thought it would come to this, but now here she was, at her sister's mercy, asking for help. She finished the letter at dawn, just as the bells of St. Stephen's rang out across the city. She sealed the envelope and placed it in the letterbox outside the front door. She would remember this day. It was the beginning.
It's wonderful how you then go back to why she was in this position. The baroness she worked for, who was so spoiled, and the poor little girl who she sends back to the parents, goes to live with her sister, and then what?
Well, she moves in with her sister to help her after her sister had just had her sixth child.
I can't believe he really had six children.
Six children. Well, Freud famously did not believe in birth control.
Famously, yes.
He thought it caused neuroses for the men. I forget what it did to the women.
Yeah.
But so his wife had one child after another. And after the sixth child, she was pretty tired. And she called her sister, Minna, who happened to be in between jobs.
Yeah.
She was a lady's companion. Of course, at age 30 in those days, if you weren't married.
She was an old lady.
That's right.
Yeah.
She was over the hill. And there weren't very many options for women in those days at that age.
Yeah.
And so you either worked for relatives or you married someone that you didn't want to marry. And
yeah.
So Minna was at a crossroads.
And she goes to live with them. And she really does take good care of the children are being homeschooled then.
Right.
Correct.
Yeah, yeah, which even made it more difficult.
Right. Martha was very afraid of diseases. So she kept, at a certain period of time, she kept all the children home. After that, some of the older children went to school, but at this period, the children were home.
And where was Sigmund Freud at this point in his career?
He was teaching at the University of Vienna. He was also a neurologist, and he had lectures every Saturday. He was a very popular professor, and he also had clients, but he was a medical doctor.
But he wasn't a full professor, though.
Priva Zadonte, or whatever it was called. I don't know how to explain it, but for years he languished, not becoming a full professor.
Yeah.
And year after year he'd put his name up and get turned down by his colleagues. And I think that's partly because of all the research and that he was doing. I think they thought he was somewhat of a nutcase.
Yeah. Was he working with B'nai B'rith at that time?
It was a couple of years afterwards. The B'nai B'rith didn't come into existence until about 1901 or 1902.
Uh-huh.
So the answer is no. But he did have a circle of friends who he played tarot cards with and mm-hmm. exchanged ideas with. They were mostly Jewish
doctors.
Doctors.
Yeah. Martha is there, welcomes her sister, and suddenly Sigmund has someone to bounce his ideas off of.
Right. He called her his, in many, he was, Freud was a prolific letter writer. And in many of his letters, he said that Minna is my closest confidant. And when she moved, they had corresponded over the years, and he would bounce ideas off her. He would talk to her about his research. Unlike Martha, who thought his work was, his wife, who thought his work was pornography, Minna thought it was fascinating. In fact, Minna thought he was a giant. She just was fascinated with his work. So.
When does it then make that transition from very good friend to very, very good friend?
Well, we know from research it was by the time they traveled to Switzerland together, which he sent home a postcard to his wife saying, Minna and I are in Switzerland on vacation, because she liked to travel with him and Martha didn't. Yeah. In those days, it wasn't as, she was just considered his sister traveling with a relative. Yeah. But we know now that they had checked into a hotel in Switzerland as Dr. Freud and Frau.
Yeah.
And we know from the old hotel log, which was recently discovered in 2006. So at least at that time, it had transitioned over to
What's interesting is that they bump into a woman who says, and do you know the Gunters? Do you know some? I mean, there is no way that they're not going to bump into somebody who knows them and plays do you know who game.
Right. Well, it's interesting. He might have, and they might have, but they really didn't get caught until 2006. The Minna question has fascinated scholars for 100 years, but all the main biographers, such as Peter Gay, all the famous, said absolutely not. He would not have had an affair with her, as revolutionary as his research was. In his own home life, he was very conservative, and it would have been completely out of character for him to have had this affair.
Yeah.
And so they really did get away with it for years.
What caught them, the letters?
What caught them was a rogue psychologist. A German psychologist followed the Freud trail in 2006, and he went to the Swiss hotel where he had written home to his wife that Min and I are at a small pension. And he went to the hotel and he discovered, you know what, it's not, it's still there and it's a grand hotel. That's odd that he would lie about that. And then he left and he came back again. There was something bothering him. So he asked the hotel, do you still have the old hotel logs? And they said, well, yeah, go in the basement. He got the dusty old hotel log and found that he had checked into a single room with a double bed, but tellingly he had signed in as Dr. Freud and Frau. So this made the New York Times. This was the big reveal. This was the smoking gun. Yeah. And this is when even Peter Gay said, well, yes, I guess they probably did have an affair. But up until then, even though the Jung, you can tell about the Jung story.
Actually, in 1950, Jung, who was
arch enemies,
but in the beginning they were totally entranced with each other, and then the relationship turned sour. But in 1950, Jung was in America and was interviewed by a professor in a kind of a journalistic newspaper,
academic journal.
And in that interview, he said that Minna had come to him at some point when he went to visit Freud and said she was highly depressed and had a terrible life because she was in love with Sigmund and he was in love with her, and she didn't know what to do. But scholars who were presented with this interview said that it was sour grapes, so it was kind of dismissed. It wasn't.
But Jung had made the whole thing up.
Yeah.
Well, she tries to get away. I mean, she really, in your version of Minna, tries to get out of this. She knows it's wrong, and all the time she's running backwards. But she goes to stay with her mother, whom she really had never gotten along with, and knew that her mother preferred Martha to her.
Well, I think...
Or is that the author's literary license?
It's Freudian.
I think in those days a mother would prefer the married, settled daughter. I mean, she thought Minna was throwing her life away, and and I think in some of the letters they didn't get along.
And she didn't get along, as you know, with Freud either. They were
the mother.
He wasn't good enough for her daughter.
Right, right. And of course, he traces, he runs after her when she goes away, and they have their time in where? Frankfurt?
Yes.
Yeah.
She went to Frankfurt. Actually, in Hamburg.
Hamburg. Yeah.
They that was in the letters as well. She took a job in Hamburg.
She went to see her mother in Hamburg and took a job in Frankfurt.
Yeah, right.
Yes.
So I love the fact, was it true that Minna worked for those two old sisters?
We have letters where she worked for an old two ladies that were they were kind of aristocracy, but that's mm-hmm. pretty much made up. The rest of them.
And even for their going off for the weekend with the interior decorator,
that's fiction. That's what a lady's companion would do in those days.
Had to be fun to write.
Well, that was wonderful because we didn't have to. So much of the book, we stuck to the facts.
Yeah.
Other than creating what happened in the relationships, most of the book surrounding Freud, from what time they had lunch to what the children looked like to Martha's arm paralysis, also the cocaine, all this stuff is real. So it was a relief for us to be able to write a few chapters that was just purely fiction.
Yeah. Well, cocaine was very common in those days, and of course, Freud was known for being a user.
Yes. Heavy user and very ecstatic about it, would write letters to his colleagues saying that it was a miracle drug and he could stay up and work and there were no side effects and it wasn't addictive and he gave it to all his friends.
Do you know how he got who brought it to him? Who gave him the coke to start with?
I think the coke was used medically among doctors for a lot of different things. And he just liked the way it made him feel. He had a lot of psychosomatic illnesses, and he took a lot of things for it. He had headaches and heartaches and
depression.
And he smoked like a fiend. And a lot of them did, they did laudanum.
Yeah.
And I think he just preferred the cocaine because he could work on it.
Yeah.
He can't work on laudanum.
It was interesting, too, how Martha would say, oh, he's in a bad mood. He lost a client. And I thought, it's what a common feeling.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, he had a hard time with expenses in those days on a professor's salary to take care of the family. And he was very, there are lots in his letters, there's lots of references to, you know, how much money is coming in, how much isn't, what they're spending. So he was very careful, except with his own antiquities and things like that.
Did he spend time with the children?
Not much.
Yeah.
Not much. And that's also, in as a matter of record, in his letters. And we read different autobiographies of different children, Martin, Anna. They all pretty much said the same thing, that the only time they really saw their father was on vacation in the summers. They would go to the mountains in Germany and Switzerland, and then they would spend maybe a week or so with him. But in general, he worked all the time, and he was not a very hands-on father.
Did Minna really become pregnant?
That was rumored, and one researcher claims that she went to have an abortion, which was pretty common in those days, actually. But we don't know for sure. All we know is that she left for us to go to a sanitarium. She said she had a lung problem, and this researcher said that's probably when she went to have an abortion. Mm-hmm. But no one knows for sure.
Yeah. So you had the fun, you had the to sort of implode that whole theory.
Well, yeah, we did. The theory that she got pregnant, is that what you're...
Yes. And the fact she then had miscarriage, thanks to the doctor.
Well,
but she had a great friendship there.
Well, the theory, it was just deductive because he didn't believe in birth control, and how long can you have relations without somebody getting pregnant?
So. Right. But up at that sanitarium, she has a friend. Oh. She makes a friend with a really delightful character.
Again, fiction. Yeah. We were able to really have a good time with that character.
Yeah. Who is also a mistress.
Right.
So mistress. It was, you know, the interesting thing about Minna was that she was such an independent woman for that time. She was actually a spectacular her intellect and very, very set in what she wanted to do and what she didn't want to do. So when we created Justine at the sanitarium, it was also to show how there were some women that were very idiosyncratic and very independent, but they were very unusual.
Mm-hmm.
And many times they were mistresses. They were the most interesting because they got out. They traveled. Yeah. They weren't housefrous.
And everybody in the family except Siggy wanted her to marry Edward, the playboy doctor.
Yes. Well, we thought we would have, obviously she would have choices, and I know that we found out that Sigmund used to have those games, and he would have the same doctors, and some of them were bachelors, so we created that.
Yeah.
But you create things, but you assume that it must have happened. Yeah. So
once she had, they were established almost as a couple or a ménage à trois, she became really part of that family and moved on to London with them when the Nazis came in.
She lived with them for 43 years.
Yes.
And when they moved to London, when they fled the Nazis in 1938, Sigmund was very sick. And this is an interesting story. Sigmund was very sick with cancer of the mouth. He was really on his final days. In fact, Virginia Woolf at that time went to see him and called him a half-extinct volcano, which I thought was interesting. But when he died, Minna went to her room and basically didn't come out and died the next year, and they said of heart failure. And everybody said she died of a broken heart, whereas Martha lived on until 1950, a long and happy life with her children.
When they were in that, what I call ménage, how would they go out in society? Would Sigmund bring along Minna or bring along Martha, the legitimate wife?
Based on photographs that we saw, they traveled. When they were with the children, both women would go. We're not sure when they went out to dinner who he would take, but she would definitely travel with him because Martha didn't like to travel. There were lots of things that Martha didn't like to do, and at that point, she took over being his companion. So
part of his being overlooked as a professor, was that because of anti-Semitism in Germany at that time?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. It was
Austria,
pre-World War I, and they are an anti-Semitic mayor had just been voted in, and the privileges that the Jews had had before 1895 slowly started going away. And also, you know, there were riots, that the public became more and more anti-Semitic. So it was definitely there. What's interesting is that Freud kept denying that it existed and would they said he had his head in the sand most of the time. He just wouldn't believe, even right before they fled to London, he still didn't want to believe it.
Unless he needed to. Sometimes he'd say, I didn't get promoted because of anti-Semitism. But basically, with his whole life, he until the very end, that's why he waited until 1938 to flee the Nazis. Mm-hmm. He just didn't think anything was going to happen to him.
I like, too, that you put at that dinner party somebody bringing up the Dreyfus case.
Yes.
But they don't pursue it.
No. But that was it was definitely going on during that period.
Yeah. Did Freud ever, in a way, analyze himself?
Oh, absolutely. His book, The Dream Book, was really his first. It was also his self-analysis. It was the breakthrough that he did. And it was really the entire Dream Book is also a self-analysis. So he was doing both at the same time in the period that we wrote the book.
Who is it, Dr. Brewer, who had no patience with him?
None. But that was not so much the Dream Book. That was because of his views on sexuality at the time, which did change. But before he did the Dream Book, he believed that women got hysterical and had bad moods because they had had trauma, sexual trauma, in their childhood. And he was very deliberate about it and very unyielding as far as his theories.
All neuroses came from sexual problems.
Uh-huh.
And that's where Brewer and some of his colleagues parted ways with him. And he had no patience for anyone who had any questions about his theories.
Yeah.
He would ban people from his life, even if they'd been as close as Brewer was his mentor.
Yeah. But there's the Dr. Fleiss, is that his name?
Correct.
Who, yeah. These are all real people.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. How did you do research? Have you been in analysis?
I haven't. How I did research is 3 years of reading everything that we could read about Freud and traveling to the Freud Museum in London, and from letters to going to universities to getting papers from Yale. And we really did 3 years. We were like anthropologists. And I must say that in Freud's personal life, I was just talking to a friend of mine who's a psychiatrist who studied Freud, and we were telling him things about Freud's personal life, and he was saying, really, really? So we don't know as much about his theories as certainly doctors who have studied him, but I defy anyone to know more about his personal life than the two of us.
What did you find interesting?
I loved reading his letters to Fleiss. They were the most revealing, I think, of anything we read in all those years. They were the most intimate and also the most emotional and passionate, both back and forth. Mm-hmm. And he really told Fleiss all of his secrets. He complained about his marriage. He complained about his health, his children, how frustrating his work was, how he was persecuted by the psychological society. They all thought he was an idiot. He thought they were idiots. It is so intimate that it's shocking once you get into it. And it's right there. It's published. It's hundreds and hundreds of letters.
Interesting that in that period, how important letters were. And the fact that once it was down, you couldn't take it back.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, nothing that says press it out. Yeah, delete. Yeah.
It's amazing they survived.
Yeah.
Some of the letters were destroyed, they think, by Anna. Some of the key letters between he and Minna, we think, were destroyed because
by
there's...
By Anna?
That's what the rumor is. I don't want to accuse her.
Yeah.
But there was a whole treasure trove of letters sent to...
Yeah.
The Smithsonian.
Smithsonian.
And a grouping of letters. And the letters were all numbered. And but the letters that would have taken place between 1895 and 1900, right when the affair would have taken place, were missing. And so there's a gap in the numbers, and everybody is wondering what that gap is.
Yeah.
And it just seems to make sense.
Anna, her function usually has been referred to as children psychoanalyst.
Right.
Did any of the other children become analysts?
No.
No.
I think so.
No. One was an engineer. One was a ladies' man. Never hold a job. I'm not sure about
that. I don't think so.
And the little one who had a speech problem, speech impediment?
She died young. She died of pneumonia in her 30s. Sophie.
He must have been some attractive man, though. You ladies have portrayed him as really quite a man, quite an attractive, dynamic human.
They said that there were all sorts of reports about what he was like in his lectures, which were packed. And they said that he would talk for 2 hours, sort of like Bill Clinton, not use a note, charismatic, sprinkling it with jokes and funny anecdotes. And mesmerizing, that he was a mesmerizing speaker and a charismatic person. So people's vision of Freud, what they have now, is this sort of older, sickly guy. But in his 40s, he was dynamic.
Yeah.
And they said he would, that's it. Throughout his life, he had women who were...
His patients.
Patients who were close to him. We don't know if it was ever physical affairs with anyone else, but certainly there were... there was big affection with certain women in his life.
Yeah. And one of those is Freud's mistress.
Yes.
Great title for the book.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I thank you both very much. Will you autograph my book? And truly, it's,
it was an honor. Thank you
so much. It was fun to read it. And I learned a great deal. I mean, that's the other part, that the fact of mixing history with fiction is very seductive for the reader. And thank you. If you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson.com or visit us at YouTube on Connie Martinson's channel. It's wonderful. Over 800,000 people have come. I mean, to maybe not to a rock star, but to me, I'm really delighted that that many people want to know about books. The other is on my website, you can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. But whatever you're doing, get a library card. Don't be a stranger to your library. If you get a library card, it helps them get funding. Or you can even donate to them, because libraries, their budgets have been cut. They need all the help they can get. And whenever you see that a library's closed on a Sunday, that's an important day for people to go in, do their homework, do their research that they can't do other days of the week. Now, if your library has a program, support it, especially the one about helping people who are illiterate learn how to read, because that is the difference between a life and not living almost. As well as if you have a problem with reading, they have large print books, and they also have helpers who will help you learn to read and read better. But what did a library mean to you both growing up?
Everything.
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 Yeah.
We had a library down the street, and we would go there all the time.
Yeah.
All the time for everything.
And I bet you remember the day your mother took you there to get a library card.
Oh, it was the first card, the first thing that you had that had your name on it.
Yeah. And you?
And the first responsibility, because you had to return them. It was down the block for me where I live. And it was my responsibility to return them.
And to return them on time.
On time.
In the condition you took them out.
That's right.
And we'll see you next time. Thank you
very
much.
Thank you so much.